We're talking about a man named Nehemiah. We started a story last week, and we're going to continue it this morning. Nehemiah's story is kind of interesting. I want to review just a little bit of where we were last week. It's a story of a new beginning. It's a story that I think has relevance to our congregation and that certainly has relevance to us as individuals as well. Nehemiah lived in the mid, forget how you count it, if it's B.C., is 445 the 5th century B.C. still? I guess that's how it is. Anyhow, this story takes place about 445 B.C. We read in the first verse of the first chapter, it was late autumn in the month of Kislev in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes' reign, and he identifies his location as living at the fortress of Susa. That was in the Persian Empire. You put all this together, Nehemiah is Jewish. This is some 140 years after the Babylonians invaded Judah and Jerusalem and took captives away. During that 140-year period, we have Daniel, we have Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego living in Babylon. Well, eventually the Medes and Persians conquered the Babylonians. And we're now 140 years later. 70 years after that destruction of Jerusalem, some people were allowed to go back, and others have gone back from different parts of the empire. Ezra has gone back and managed to help rebuild the temple, although it was much smaller than the Temple of Solomon's, which had been destroyed. But things are still troubled back home. And as Nehemiah's story begins, we find him living in Susa, apparently never having been to his homeland. I'm not sure the exact situation of every individual. Nehemiah had a position. He was the cupbearer to the king of Persia. I don't know if just anyone was free to go back or not, but here you have someone who still feels very much identified with his homeland, though he apparently has never been there. And his homeland is in disarray. As the chapter begins, he has some visitors come, a brother of his apparently, and some others who come, and he asks them, "How are things back in Jerusalem?" And they say, "Things aren't going so well." And Nehemiah's heart is broken. And he grieves, he mourns for days, and he turns to God in prayer. And over a period of about 5 months, Nehemiah is praying about the situation back in his homeland. And I think about that even as we gather on this Memorial Day weekend, and as we sang at the outset here this morning, America the Beautiful, and if you're like me, we feel a lot of emotion when we sing that song and others like it. And we feel such a deep love and care for our homeland. And we live here. No, things aren't perfect. So maybe we can at least imagine some of Nehemiah. I mean, imagine that we're living overseas someplace and we hear about what's going on back in our homeland and we want to come back and help. Imagine if on 9/11 you were living overseas and you just see on the news and you get reports about what has happened back here and you'd want to be back here. Not sure if there's anything you could do about it or not, but maybe we can overlay some of that on where Nehemiah perhaps has been. Well, as we learned last week, one of the first things to do in times of trouble is to seek help. And the place to start is to seek help of God. And that's exactly what Nehemiah did. And God led him over those 5 months. God kind of formed a plan and a prayer in his heart. And And that plan and prayer involved going to the king and asking the king for help. And so we read his prayer where he says, "Oh God, give me success as I go before the king." And then chapter 2 tells us now that it's about 5 months later, and Nehemiah was serving the king his wine. And we'll pick up the story. We read part of this already. He says, "I'd never before appeared sad in his presence. So the king asked me, 'Why are you looking so sad? You don't look sick to me. You must be deeply troubled.'" Nehemiah says, "Well, then I was terrified. But I replied, 'Long live the king. How can I not be sad? For the city where my ancestors are buried is in ruins, and the gates have been destroyed by fire.' The king asked, 'Well, how can I help you?'" The account continues. Nehemiah says, "With a prayer to the God of heaven, I replied, 'If it please the king, and if you are pleased with me, your servant, send me to Judah to rebuild the city where my ancestors are buried.' The king, with the queen sitting beside him, asked, 'How long will you be gone? When will you return?' After I told him how long I would be gone, the king agreed to my request. I also said to the king, 'If it please the king, let me have letters addressed to the governors of the province west of the Euphrates River, instructing them to let me travel safely through their territories on my way to Judah. And please give me a letter addressed to Asaph, the manager of the king's forest, instructing him to give me timber. I will need it to make beams for the gates of the temple fortress, for the city walls, and for a house for myself.' And the king granted these requests, because the gracious hand of God was on me." And that's where we left things last week. But the story doesn't end there. Nehemiah begins his journey. Verse 9, chapter 2, "When I came to the governors of the province west of the Euphrates River, I delivered the king's letters to them. The king, I should add, had sent along army officers and horsemen to protect me." Then verse 10 gives us our first glimpse of another character in this story. "But when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard of my arrival, they were very displeased that someone had come to help the people of Israel." That's all that's said about that for now. Imagine watching a movie and you're introduced to the main plot, you're introduced to the main characters, and then somewhere along the line you just get this snapshot of these sinister person. It doesn't say much about them, and you get the feel, uh-oh, I bet we're going to see them again. Well, that's what's just happened, okay? So we will hear from Sanballat and his sidekick, Tobiah, a little bit later. But meanwhile, back to the main story. Next verse, Nehemiah writes, "So I arrived in Jerusalem." Not told what he did for the first 3 days, but it says, "3 days later, I slipped out during the night, taking only a few others with me. I had not told anyone about the plans God had put in my heart for Jerusalem. We took no pack animals with us except the donkey I was riding. After dark, I went out through the valley gate, past the jackal's well." Interesting, you wonder how these places got their names. "Over to the dung gate." Now you're really wondering how things got their names. "To the king's pool," next to the dung gate. That was poor planning, I think. Maybe it's not right next. "But my donkey couldn't get through the rubble. So though it was still dark, I went up the Kidron Valley instead, inspecting the wall before I turned back and entered again at the valley gate. The city officials did not know I had been out there or what I was doing, for I had not yet said anything to anyone about my plans. I had not yet spoken to the Jewish leaders, the priests, the nobles, the officials, or anyone else in the administration. But now I said to them, 'You know very well what trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins and its gates have been destroyed by fire. Let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem and end this disgrace.' Then I told them about how the gracious hand of God had been on me and about my conversation with the king. They replied at once, 'Let us rebuild the wall.' So they began this good work." I want you to notice a few things in this story. And then we're going to make some application, and then I'm going to share an illustration. Okay? I want you to notice when Nehemiah lays out the case to the king says, "What's going on? You're sad." And he says, "Long live the king. How can I not be sad? The city where my ancestors are buried is in ruins. The gates have been destroyed by fire." Okay? Focus in on that word city. The city is in ruins. The king agrees. Later on, he says, "So I arrived in Jerusalem." 3 days later, he slips out during the night, and he says, "I had not told anyone about the plans God had put in my heart for Jerusalem. I had not yet said anything to anyone about my plans," he says again, verse 16. Then verse 17, "But now," after he takes his tour around the city, inspecting it, he says, "But now I said to them, you know very well what trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins." Once again, that's the whole city, he's saying. The city is in ruins. Now he's saying Jerusalem is in ruins. Its gates have been destroyed by fire. Let us rebuild what? The wall of Jerusalem and end this disgrace. Then I told them about how the gracious hand of God had been on me and about my conversation with the king. So let's identify where we are here. What's happened in this story? First, Nehemiah becomes aware of the desperate situation in Jerusalem. Then Nehemiah grieves over the situation and desired to help. He grieved and he desired to help rebuild the city or to do something about it. Then he sought help from the God of heaven. Then God put plans in Nehemiah's heart for how to accomplish this desire. Then Nehemiah sought help from the king. Then Nehemiah arrived in Jerusalem and assessed the need for himself. Then Nehemiah established a priority. And that priority gave specific shape to his plan. And then Nehemiah proposed the plan to the city officials. And they replied at once, "Yes, let's do it." The whole city was in ruins, more or less. But Nehemiah identified a priority. We need to rebuild the walls. Not everything, at least not yet. We've got to start someplace. And this is the priority. This is where we need to start. And that priority gave shape to a plan. Any of this language sound familiar to anybody? I see a few smiles out there. I said, "Oh yeah, you're messing with us here." No, I'm not messing with you. That's what happened in Nehemiah's day, and that's kind of what's happening here this year. We could kind of use the same outline and talk about our congregation. We could say that there was a time last year and maybe even before that when there was not a single Nehemiah, when many within the congregation were aware of the not entirely desperate situation at Indian Creek. There was not a crisis, there was not panic, but a growing sense that we needed to do something. A growing sense that we needed a renewed vision. We needed a sense of united vision and direction. And so we're going to make that parallel here this morning. And I would go even so far to say that some grieved the situation and desired to help renew the congregation. And some sought help from the God of heaven. And I believe that the God of heaven put plans in the hearts of the leadership team as for how to accomplish this desire. And part of that involved consulting, not a king, but in this case, a Christian organization. We come to know them as the Center. The Center helped Indian Creek to assess the needs more specifically. And Indian Creek, through its catalyst team, is discerning three priorities. And those three priorities will give shape to a particular plan. And if all goes according to timing, by the end of the summer, the catalyst team, along with the leadership team, will propose the plan to the congregation. And the congregation will say, that remains to be seen. I hope the parallels continue, that we'll recognize not only the need, as we have, and the whole congregation has been part of this process, in assessing, even last Sunday evening, 50 of you turned out to help us focus in and discern, confirm really what the assessment on paper had already showed, but where the areas of priority are. And now the catalyst team is going to be meeting and working on fine-tuning that and letting the plan flow from that to be able to come back to the congregation at the end of the summer and say, here's the plan. Let's do this. So it's really not a stretch to see some parallels here. And the key for this morning is the importance of priority-based planning. It was important for Nehemiah, in order to really have reasonable success in rebuilding the city, to establish, to discern, to assess the needs and discern where to start. What is the priority? And to have that priority based not just on what he'd heard, but based on some reasonable research and even an eyewitness, even to take this nighttime look all around the city so he could see for himself, so he had the confidence of saying, this really is the right thing to do, the right place to start, the right priority for us. To then have confidence in going to the people and saying, let's do this. Let's do this. Without priority established, just to come back and say, hey, let's rebuild Jerusalem. Well, was there a plan? Well, no, but let's rebuild Jerusalem. That's the plan. Well, kind of hard to get energized around that, isn't there? You walk out the door of your home, which maybe is still in ruins itself, and there's just all this rubble. I mean, there's so much rubble that Nehemiah couldn't even get his donkey through the gate to do his tour the way he intended. It looks pretty hopeless. It looks overwhelming. And without priority, without a plan, without people coming together around that plan, you could have this person said, okay, well, I'll pick up this rock. And someone else says, well, I'll pile a rock over here. And you need people working together, not moving in all different directions. Certainly that's true of a church, too, that's seeking a new chapter and seeking God's guidance for where we should focus and seeking a renewed sense of vision of what is it that God's calling us to here at Indian Creek. We could all work independently and do our own things and still really miss the sense of what are we called to do together. And I think that just really underscores the wisdom of the path that we're on, the wisdom of discerning priorities together and letting those priorities give shape to a plan that has very specific steps in it. And that's what the target is. That's what the goal is here. They actually call it a priority-based action plan. It's not plans just to think about things. It's plans to do things, just like Nehemiah. Let's come together and let's build this wall. I think it's important for us as individuals, too, in our lives, to take time to think about what are the priorities, what are the most important things. And I want to share an illustration that many of you have seen before. I haven't practiced this, so that's the disclaimer. I've seen it done, so we'll see how it works. It's not a magic trick. It's an illustration that reminds us a little bit about the importance of priorities. These rocks represent what's really most important in life. And to the best of my ability, these rocks are about the same size. And Sometimes there are things that are also important, they're just not the most important. And that's what these represent. And then there are all those other things that we seem to spend the most time with that are really the least important of the lot. And that's these. And these. To the best of my ability, these are all very evenly supplied here. So the illustration goes like this. And I remember this from Charlene Rock, shared this a lot of years ago as a children's story. And so what often happens in most of our lives when we're not living by what's most important, when that's not clearly and solidly at the center of our life, we kind of let our life get filled with the least important things. That's just kind of the natural trend. If we're not intentional, that's kind of what ends up happening an awful lot. You know, it's interesting, and I'm not criticizing anyone. It's just kind of the way we are in our culture a lot of times. Even, you know, we have sign-up sheets for things in the back, and it's like, well, you know, I'll wait kind of till the last week, and if I don't have anything else to do, then I'll sign up and I'll come to that event, okay? That's kind of the mindset. And that's, again, that's human nature. I'm not criticizing. Sometimes that's because of our priorities, but sometimes that's kind of how we live in terms of, in relation to things that really are most important. And I'm not saying that every program we have here, that every event we have here is most important. I'm not trying to say that. I will say that God in the center of our life is most important. So we allow our time and our focus and our lives to become filled up with things first, with things that are less important. So this is sand. It's actually blue sand. I would say I chose it on purpose. It was actually the only sand I found at Walmart. It just happened to be blue so that if I spill it, Don, it'll blend right in, okay? All right? So there's two cupfuls because that's what usually happens. And then we get the things that are a little more important, and sure, we're going to make time for those. And so I'll add these colored stones in there. And then we start to get the things that are more important. And so let's see, I've got that rock, I've got that rock, I've got that rock, I've got that rock, and well, there's not quite room there. It doesn't all fit, so I guess I better leave that out. Oops, it just so happened to be the most important, the biggest rock of all. Well, sorry, there's not room for it, but that's just kind of the way things go. And you know how this goes. Let's see if we can put the most important things in first. Now, that's a rock and this is glass. So I'm going to try to do this very carefully. You know, I tried to choose these carefully. I really think these are looking bigger than the other ones, so I'm not sure that these are good. I'm not sure this is going to work. Like I said, I did not practice it. So once we get in what's most important, then we can move down and we put in what's next important. All right. And then in the space that's left over, we let it be filled with things that are less important. And if we need to shake it up a little bit, they say that helps, you know. And look at that. There's that, and there's even room for more. It's funny how that works. Just a visual example. It's not magic. I guess it's science. It's life. And maybe it's something we'll remember and will help us to think of the importance of priorities for a church, to make sure that what should be first is first, and for our individual lives. It's important for all of us. Next week's graduation week, so I just may keep these around and talk about them next week too. We'll see. So think about that for yourself. Think about that for our church and this process we're in. I'm excited about where this plan is leading us. And you stay tuned. And together, I believe that God will lead us. And I believe we'll do that for you too. You seek him first. His kingdom, his righteousness, all these other things will be added.